Amen indeed. Woo, yes, I'd like to welcome everyone who is here today and also those who are watching on Facebook to Zwingli United Church of Christ on this Transfiguration Sunday. Glad that you are here. And if you are watching on Facebook, welcome. You're welcome to chat, to share, to do all the things that you're used to doing. Those who are here, you're also welcome to participate in the ways that you can in the service. If you wanted to throw out another amen here and there, that would be great. So anyway, whatever way in which you would like to participate in the service, that would be wonderful today. And we'd like to also welcome any visitors who are here with us, any visitors who might be on Facebook as well, and glad you are with us today. Also like to welcome Rich Spots, who is substituting for Steve Emery. As many of you know, Steve had surgery on his back, and I did see Steve this past week. He is doing well and recovering well, and hope that he will be back in the saddle, as they say, I guess, or maybe back on the bench. That's maybe the better thing to say, back on the bench. Hopefully he will be back on the bench pretty soon. So glad that he is healing well. And I'm gonna make this one announcement. I'll make other announcements later, but make this one announcement now, and maybe if I remember to make it again later. At the recessional, when we begin to go out, as the acolyte comes in and snuffs the candles and takes the light out into the world, we will all be following that light. So when the recessional begins, please remain seated so that the acolyte can get out and the acolyte is not having to tackle anyone to get, you know, to the back door, all right? So if you could just stay seated, you know, stay a little calm. Being in the worship space a little bit longer is not going to hurt you. In fact, it's going to help you a lot. So I hope that you will do that. So I have a number of prayer requests to share with you today. And so I hope that you will keep in prayer not only today, but in the week ahead. Prayers for Bobby Rouse, who had a medical procedure done, and she's doing okay, but just prayers for her. Carol Reef also asks for a couple of prayers, one for a coworker and friend of their daughter Stephanie. The friend's name is Kayla, and her two sons are Kiko and Kaysen, and they lost everything in a house fire on Wednesday, and so prayers for them. Also prayers for David, who is also scheduled for additional surgery on his foot. There's another open wound that will not heal. And so prayers for David as he faces that surgery, which will happen on March 11th. Also prayers for Mike Smead's Aunt Jean. She's in the hospital with congestive heart failure. They're trying to figure out why, and so prayers for her as well as those who are treating her and helping her. Also, we just heard or saw on the Facebook chat that Kyle Sakamoto would like prayers for himself and for his family. And we also pray for the families of those lost in the plane crash in Hatfield this past week, a horrifying event for that community. And even more horrifying, or just as horrifying, or however you want to describe it, prayers for the Ukrainian people and for all the things that are happening there. And we all pray for peace, but what we hopefully, or what we need to pray for as well, is that hearts will change so that it will make room for peace. And too many hearts are closed off with hate and with power. And so we pray for those whose hearts are closed, that they will be opened and that we can indeed move towards ways of peace. And I also want to thank you for your prayers for my family and for Sally and me for traveling mercies. My mother is now stable after a major medical crisis, but she is on hospice care. And so prayers for her and for all those who will be attending to her and taking care of her. Prayers also for my father. I think he's holding up pretty well, but things are pretty tough for him right now. He's really struggling physically and emotionally and in just about every way you can imagine. And so prayers for them as well. And so thank you for your prayers. Those are all the prayer requests that I have to share this morning. Again, if you have any prayer requests during the week, please make sure they get to the church office or to Pastor Allen or to me. I also want to thank Pastor Allen and the elders and leaders for stepping up and doing the things that they always do It is so comforting to be able to go away at a moment's notice and know that all will be well, and in fact, it might even be better that I'm gone. So that's a wonderful, wonderful thing to be able to feel. And so thank you to Alan and the elders and leaders. Let us now prepare our hearts and minds for worship. For those who are able, please stand for the call to worship. God speaks to us in various ways,
calling us to be lovers of justice, to share hope with the broken.
On mountaintops and in neighborhoods, Christ calls to us,
with a word and with wonder, molding us into who we are.
On the playground and at the workstation, the Spirit whispers in our hearts,
gathering our fears as well as our dreams and offering them to God.
Let us worship and praise the God of transformation and new life.
Thank you. Will you pray with me? Reveal the glory of Christ to us this day as you revealed it to Peter, James, and John on that mountaintop long ago. Transform our worship with the light of discovery that our souls might shine the light of Christ into a world in need of your healing and grace. Amen. Will you join me in the prayer of confession? God of all creation, ruler of all peoples, you know us completely. We humbly confess the mistakes we have made and the good we have neglected, the promises we have broken and the duties we have refused. Let the power and joy of your love and mercy become a mighty force in our lives. Help us to develop the good that is in us so that we may live in faithfulness to you. Forgive us and guide us by your life-giving grace, given through your Son, Jesus Christ. God hears the cries of the brokenhearted and renews the strength of those who trust in his mercy. In Jesus Christ, God has taken us by the hand, forgiven our sins, and lifted us to new life. Amen.
We gather this day in the peace of Christ. And so I say to you, the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us share Christ's peace with one another.
Come on up for a children's moment. How are you two this morning? Doing fine? All right. You guys seem like you're really awake. That's good. I got plenty of sleep last night, too, so I am wide awake. That's great. So I have a question for you. Have you ever taken a vacation? Yes, you have. Like, what's been your favorite place to go?
Probably Rhode Island.
Rhode Island? What about you?
Outer Banks.
The Outer Banks? Nice. There's, like, lots of good vacations to go on, right? And it's interesting, I think about that in light of Jesus and his disciples. Jesus called his disciples, and I think they had no idea all of the cool experiences they would get to have as they travel with Jesus around the neighborhoods that they were in. So can you think of, what are some of the moments you think of in Jesus' ministry? Are there places that you think are cool that he did, or experiences they had? No. Okay. So, like, I think of when they went on the Sea of Galilee and they experienced the storm and Jesus calmed the waters, and they fed the 5,000. They had all these cool experiences. But today's story is actually probably one of the more interesting ones for me. It was Jesus invited Peter, James, and John to go up on the mountain with him and pray. And they got up there, and they fell asleep. And while Jesus was praying, Jesus was transformed. He was transfigured, which is what we call today. We call it today Transfiguration Sunday. When he was praying, his face and his clothes became white and shining. And all of a sudden, Peter woke up and he saw what was going on. And he saw that Jesus was praying not only by himself, but with Elijah and Moses. And Peter got really excited and he said, okay, I'm going to, well, and I should say this. And then he saw that Moses and Elijah were getting ready to leave. And he said, I'm going to build three tents so that we can stay up here and enjoy this mountaintop experience together. And he heard God say, listen to my son. I love him. And basically, Jesus told him, you know, our goal is to not stay here, but to go back down and to go out and live life. And so it's easy for us to want to always be on vacation or to always have a mountaintop experience. But it's when we leave the mountain and we go down and we experience life that we get to live out and have all these amazing experiences and enjoy the mountaintops when they do happen. So just keep that in mind as you go through life. Like if there's like a big moment where you just want to stay in it, there's so much more to happen in life than just the mountaintop experiences. So I invite you to keep that in mind. Let's pray together. Holy One, thank you for the mountaintop experiences. They lift us up and give us life as we go out into the world. Help us to enjoy not only those, but all of the moments in our lives in service and in love to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you all. Our Hebrew Bible lesson comes from Exodus 34, verses 29 to 35. Hear these words. Moses came down from the mount, from Mount Sinai, as he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hand. Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin of his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses spoke with them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin of his face was shining, and Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him again. May God add a blessing to the hearing and reading of these words.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rich. And thank you for leaving us hanging. That's a great ending. That's wonderful. That's wonderful. Our gospel lesson is found in the gospel according to Luke chapter 9, beginning with the 28th verse. Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep. But since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of God's holy word. So as I was listening to Pastor Allen's children's message, I realized that his sermon and my sermon kind of matched up pretty well. So I can get rid of this page. Let's see, this one. I might be able to get some stuff in here. But thank you, Allen. I mean, I hope that a lot of times it's good to hear a story over and over again. So it really will sink deeply into your mind, heart, and soul. And today is a day in which we talk about mountaintop experiences, and I'm sure many of you have experienced mountaintop experiences in your life. The birth of a child, a wedding, a 50th anniversary, times in which there are things that you celebrate to, you know, so much and so well because it's been such a good thing for you or for your family or for those that you know. Well, today is a story about mountaintop experiences and about a lot else. It's Transfiguration Sunday, a day in which we focus on the scripture just read that tells the story about Jesus being transfigured on the mountain as he, along with Peter and John and James, go to pray. And we are told, as we heard in the children's lesson, that Jesus' face changes, it becomes bright, and his clothes become dazzling white. We can only imagine what that scene must have been like. And Moses and Elijah show up and they speak with Jesus, perhaps about what is to come. And we think about Moses being there because Moses had mountaintop experiences too. In fact, we read about some of those mountaintop experiences in the Hebrew Bible lesson today, where his face shone, where he had to wear a veil because it was so bright because of his connection with and his interaction with God. And we also know about Elijah and his mountaintop experiences, defeating the prophets of Baal, but then running away in fear and going to a mountain, to a cave, and there at the cave, being encountered with God, being met by God, God coming to Elijah, not in a fire, not in an earthquake, not in any of those things, but in a still small voice or a sound of sheer silence. And so we have these three, and we have the disciples who are there who are watching all of these different things happening, these mountaintop experiences. And this is a really interesting story, a spectacular story. But as spectacular a story it is, it has some down-to-earth wisdom for the disciples. It has down-to-earth wisdom that's as true for them back then as it is true for us today. So let's think about some of those lessons that we are taught in Scripture today. Peter, I have to tell you, is a disciple I can really identify with. He makes colossal blunders, and he really does. If you read about Peter, he messes up all the time. But he also is a disciple that often seems to get it sooner than others. I hope that I can get it sooner than others sometimes myself. But I also know I make colossal blunders, so I can really identify with Peter. He is not only the rock on whom Jesus will build the church, but he's also the disciple
who betrays Jesus at a really critical moment.
In this story, Peter wants to capture the moment. It's like the two Peters are working side by side, one that realizes just how much a mountaintop experience this is, and the other side that wants to capture this experience. He wants to build booze. It's like he wants to take a picture so he can keep looking at it and make sure that he remembers that experience, or like taking a selfie, you know, like you do sometimes when you're at places. You take a selfie of those places that you really like, that you want to remember. That's what he's doing. But Jesus, God, have other plans. As Peter is speaking, a cloud overshadows he and the other disciples and Jesus. And as the cloud comes around, as a cloud envelops them, they are terrified. And in the midst of their fear, God repeats, they hear a voice, the voice of God, repeating what God said at the baptism, at Jesus' baptism, that Jesus is God's son, God's chosen, God's beloved. But then he adds something else that's very important to what the disciples and we need to hear. God tells the disciples and us to listen. Listening is an important trait, an important value to cultivate. I find in our society today, it's something that we really are losing a grasp on. We have trouble listening to others. We have trouble even being in conversation with other people. We have difficulty really hearing some of the words, but then we need to hear the feelings behind the words. There's a lot of listening we need to do. There's a book that I love that is called Listening is an Act of Love. Think about that. When you're in relationship with someone, no matter how great that relationship might be, or even if that relationship is something that just happened yesterday, whenever you listen and listen deeply to another person, and they know that they're being listened to, that is an act of love. Listening is critical to pastoral care or giving care to others. Our Stephen ministers have gone through a lot of training. And if you had to boil down that training to one or two or three concepts, one of the most important ones would be listening. When talking to others about pastoral care, this is the word that keeps coming up. This is the word, the concept, the activity, the action that is most important when you're in a relationship with someone and you care deeply for them, when you're offering care to them. The most important thing to do is to listen. One of the things that was difficult for me to do in this past week was to listen. As we were sharing in our grief, as we were sharing in the feelings that we experienced, it was oftentimes hard to hear the pain. It was hard to listen. When I had feelings inside of me that I just wanted to let out, yet I needed to hear the feelings that my father had, I can't tell you how hard it was to listen. But listening is an act of love. We all need to train ourselves in this way of being in the world, to listen. It's a command from God. Listen to Jesus. Listen for my voice. Listen for what we are to do and how we are to act in the world. Listening is incredibly important to our faith. And sometimes we need to stop talking all the time and just listen. In the midst of all this listening, In the midst of these relationships we need to build because God calls us to do this, in the midst of all the things that are going on in the world, in the midst of all of this stuff going on around us, and we know how we need to cultivate listening and cultivate relationship and cultivate love and cultivate all of these different things we're called to do, we also know that there's something that's always in the background, something always there in our heart and soul, something that's very difficult sometimes to deal with, and that is fear. As the disciples became shrouded in the cloud, they were terrified. I know how it feels to be terrified. I know how it is to be on the streets or in a place where you're not sure with what you say is going to offend someone, or they're going to react in a certain way that's going to be harmful or hateful. And I think some of you also have had fears in the midst of your life too. Fears about what the test result might say. Fears about surgery that's coming up. Fears about relationships that are broken. Fears that might exist when you have to put a loved one on hospice. Will we get COVID? Will it harm people that we love? What about the fear that black and brown people and LGBTQ people and people who with disabilities have each and every day just going out the door? Fear can surround us. That fear of unknowing. That fear that we can't see what's in front of us. That fear of wondering what the outcome might be. That fear of the hatred and the harm that people will indeed try to pass on to you. There are people out there who, I don't know why, they want to harm others. I think about the Ukraine, it's like, that's insane. Don't we have enough trouble in the world? Why are you choosing power and creating fear over the other things that God calls us to do? I thought about this flag that I found was hanging in the sanctuary, one that was in the office for a while, and one we're trying to decide what to do and when we will do it. It's a flag that represents us being open and affirming. For some of us, that flag represents a mountaintop experience, because it is a flag that represents our love for others, our acceptance of others, our affirmation of others, all those things that God calls us to do. It also represents our love for creation, for all that God has created. Yet for other people, that is a flag in which they feel fear. And I want to acknowledge that fear as well. Because some people fear that if we wave that flag too much, that we will indeed be the object of hate and ridicule and harm. People believe that if we wave the flag too much, that we will be misunderstood for what we stand for, and some might even call us unchristian. There are others, when they see this flag, that causes hate to rise up inside of them, because they don't feel a love for people different from them. What I love about this passage and about the disciples who were shrouded by fear is that in the midst of that, God speaks to them. God speaks about Jesus. Jesus being this chosen one. Jesus being God's son. Jesus being beloved. Jesus being the one they should follow and listen to. And that is the message too for us today, in the midst of our fear, in the midst of our mountaintop experiences, whatever they may be. We are always being called to listen to Jesus, to follow Jesus, to do whatever we can to be responsible in our faithful walk, as responsible as we possibly can be, knowing that, yes, we might get it wrong like the Peters of the world, but also knowing that Jesus will call us again and again and again to be the church in the world. I personally believe that flag represents us being the church in the world. But I also know that people have fears. And so just as I talked about earlier, we need to listen to one another. Listen to what the fears might be. Listen to what the mountaintop experiences are, and try to allow God to be in the midst of that conversation so that we will continue to be transformed and change, so that we can indeed go up to the mountaintop, but yes, come back down from the mountain and live in the world, as Pastor Allen so eloquently said to the kids. I think children's messages are sometimes the best messages of all. And that's the message that we are hearing this day, to listen in the midst of our fear, to realize that God is indeed with us, but to know that we also are to go down the mountain and live in the world, to carry that message of Jesus, to carry that life of Jesus, to carry that way of Jesus into a world that we certainly know is broken. What I love too about this story is it is at a juncture in Luke's gospel. Up to this point, Jesus' ministry of healing and preaching and serving, miracles, all of those things, all have come to this pinnacle point, this mountaintop experience. And just after he leaves this mountaintop experience, other things will happen, but Jesus is moving towards Holy Week, towards that time in which he goes into Jerusalem, where he is tried, where he is hung on a cross, and in which he is raised from the dead. What's really interesting about this pinnacle is this light that happens, right? We hear about Jesus' face shining, his clothes being bright. We hear about this light of Christ in a different way. A light of Christ we heard about in a different way during Christmas and Epiphany, but the light of Christ we hear in a different way on Transfiguration. And that light shines on both sides of the mountain in the ministry that he did up to that point, and shines also on what is going to happen. And what we need to understand, I think, in all of this, is this is something that is indeed about the glory of Christ, about the light of Christ, but we also need to understand that we also are the body of Christ, right? We are the body of Christ. We too are called to shine that light into the world. We too are called not to just go up to the mountain and forget about everyone else when we come down, but to come back into the world to shine the light of Christ. I hope that we will have the courage to do those things today and in the future. Because if we've learned anything from the disciples, it will not be easy. But it'll indeed be something that will be fulfilling and meaningful. It'll be something that we are called to do. And when we follow in the way of Jesus, when we follow God's call for us, then we know that healing and transformation and love and compassion and all of those wonderful things that we read about in Scripture, that we hear about in stories, can become alive in our lives each and every day. So may Christ live in you. May Christ's light shine in you. May Christ's light become alive in the world that we inhabit. May we indeed share that light with others. Amen.
affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us now go to God in prayer. Holy One, we thank you for your light which entered this world in Jesus Christ, and for the lessons we learn on the mountaintops and the light we carry into the world from those mountaintops as we spread your love and light in the world, as we learn to listen better and to love others even better every day, to strengthen our relationships. We thank you for your love and your guidance so much, and for all the lessons we learn as we study about your Son and we study your word. We come to you this day out of love for our neighbor and our friends and the world. And so we ask you to listen on our behalf and to do your will as we lift up those we love and care for. We pray for Bobby Ralphs as she recovers from surgery. Pray that she would be healed. We pray for Mike Smead's Aunt Jean. Help them to diagnose what's going on and to get an accurate understanding of what's happening with her body so that she can be restored to health. We pray for Stephanie, for Kayla, and for her two sons, Kiko and Kaysen. Losing everything in a fire has to be devastating. We just pray that they would find comfort and peace and that you would help to restore their life to normal. We pray for David too this week as he is scheduled for another surgery on his foot. We pray that he would be healed and that he could continue to make progress with his foot. We think of our communities as well. We think of the families that had losses this week in a plane crash that happened in Hatfield. We just pray that those families would know your comfort and your peace and make sense out of this tragedy. We think of Ukraine, the people who are displaced, who are fleeing, those who are staying and fighting. We pray that your peace would reign. Even as in the middle of worship, we get an announcement that Putin wants to ramp up his nuclear weapons for the West. Scary times. And we just ask that your peace would reign and that cooler heads would prevail and that you would help us all to make wise decisions. We're grateful that Butch's mom is doing better, but there's lots of things happening ahead, and we just pray for guidance and wisdom for them as they walk this path. We're thankful for Pastor Butch as our senior pastor. We just pray that you would give him guidance and wisdom and strength as he goes on these weeks ahead. We pray too for Kyle, who continues to struggle. We just ask that you would help him, guide him, and direct him. We ask all these things in the name of the risen Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and power and glory forever. Amen. I just realized there is a stewardship moment in our bulletin. Who is that that's going to come forward for us? Please come on up.
Good morning. So a few weeks ago, Pastor Butch's sermon talked about casting your net out farther and deeper and how we are all called to God to do something. Well, it got me to thinking. I thought I usually live in the shallow end, and if I can't see where my net is being thrown, I'm not going out there. However, when I received the call to be on the stewardship committee, I thought, well, here's my chance to do something. I can become more active in the church and get to know more people. Then I found out that I would have to get up and talk in front of you all at least 2 times a year and do things with numbers. For anyone who knows me, that is casting the net out way, way out in the deep end. But I've been doing it for a few years, and guess what? I'm doing okay. So I started thinking, what else can I do? I started looking at my budget and my weekly spending and where I can spend less to give more. Do I really need that $4 Dunkin' coffee every day, or could I cut back to at least 1 time a week and maybe learn how to make my own coffee? Do I really need to get my nails done as often when I'm still working at home and no one really sees them? Don't look too closely. Do I need the brand name leggings that look exactly like the Walmart pair for $388? When I finally figured it out, I realized I have more money to share. And with the electronic offering Zwingli provides, I am giving more often than ever. Not only am I giving at the Sundays that I'm here at church, but I am also giving every Sunday in the summer when I'm 2 hours away at the lake. And the fact that I don't have to run around the house looking for envelopes and write a check every Sunday, well, that's just an added plus. Technically, our stewardship committee is over. However, because we have received less faith promises than in the past, we are asking those of you who have not returned your faith promise card to consider doing so. You can ask one of us if you still need a card. We are currently at 51 faith promises submitted for a total of $234,036, of which $201,684 was pledged for general funds, $22,052 for missions, and $10,300 towards building loan principal. This represents only 50% of our budget, 2002 budget. Normally, our stewardship committee campaigns result in a pledge that equals about 65 to 70% of the budget. You can still turn in your faith promise card in the offering plates or mail it to the office. Note on the envelope that there is a pledge card inside, and the financial secretary will separate the cards and provide them to the stewards. Now is the time in our service for your offering. If you have not already done so, you can put your donation in the back plates on the table as you leave. Or if you are at home, you can click the Donate Now button on our website and mail your offering to the church office. I've read somewhere that a generous person doesn't have to be the person who gives the most. It is just someone who gives. So thank you to all the generous people here at Zwingli. Thank you.
Let us go to God in prayer. Your importance in our lives, O God, is reflected in our gifts. We return to you through the ministry and outreach of this church a portion of all that you have entrusted to us. We promise that these offerings will not be the end of our giving. We will also invest our time and abilities in ministries that reflect the light of Christ, working with you to bring healing and hope to a broken world. Bless each gift and multiply the good to be done through our talents and treasure. We pray these things in your name. Amen. I ask that you take a look at the back of the bulletin where the announcements are, and there's a lot of announcements in there about different things happening at Zwingli. I will highlight one thing that will be happening. It's the Lenten program and Ash Wednesday service. Ash Wednesday service will be here at Zwingli on March 2nd at 7 p.m. We'll be worshiping with Emmanuel and Trinity UCC. And so hope that you can be here for that. And then there's also more description about the Lenten program. And if you want to be a part of that, it's a Bible study. There's a book that you will need to purchase. And so there's information in the bulletin about that. So hopefully you will be a part of the Lenten program and Lenten services that we will have this year. I have a special announcement, an announcement that makes me really happy and really glad. And when I first heard about this possibility, I was incredibly excited. And so things have come to fruition. We've gotten through all the things we needed to go through to be able to announce to you that Art Clyde, he and Carol have moved back, which is a wonderful thing. But Art will begin work as our choir director. That doesn't mean that Steve is leaving. Steve is actually going to be the music director and organist. But they'll be working hand in hand, side by side. I think it was something that they did years ago as well when Steve was organist and you were music director. So Art will be choir director. And for those of you who are money wonks, because of stewardship that we just heard about, it's going to have no impact to the budget this year. So see? He's working for free. Not really. And I did want to add with the stewardship moment, Tara, you speak in front of people really well. So Pastor Allen and I have already penciled you in for preaching on March 27th. So that's good. That's good. Also, there's going to be a choir meeting today that the choir has been alerted to. You were told that it was going to be in the sanctuary, but we've moved that to the parlor. So immediately following the service, after you've waited for the acolyte and the pastors to leave, if the choir could go to the parlor. For those of you waiting for adult electives, please just be patient until that begins. A lot of the adult electives attenders are also in choir. For those of you who may not be in choir, do know that the adult electives will begin in the sanctuary as soon as that meeting is over. So just wanted to let you know those things. So now let us stand and sing, Lord, whose love and humble service.
Thank you.
As you go out today, may you follow in the way of Christ. May you listen deeply for the voice of God. And may you be inspired to serve in the way God has called you. And as you do, may the grace of God and the presence of Christ and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit